Hey guys, how you going? Campbell here from Autodidactic Channel. And of course, autodidactic means to be self-educated. And guys, you want to be self-educated because you do not want to be learning what they're trying to teach you. Now, this is part two of my videos on Malta. This is called Malta Subterranean Tunnels, Lost Children and Elongated Skulls. So to start with, I just want to show that Malta is covered in megalithic ancient sites. It just is for a tiny little island or group of islands. It's covered. Like, as you can see, these are all shots, and as you can see, we've got megalithic lintels here, megalithic stonework. We've got all these enclosures. It's almost reminiscent of what Michael Tellinger is studying down in Southern Africa. More megalithic, lintels, all this kind of stuff. We've got carvings, we've got underground caverns, ancient, old world architecture. Like, they've just got it all. They've got the carvings. You see this stuff, the spirals, that's everywhere on ancient petroglyphs. So just to show you what's on Malta, like, there's a lot and a lot of variety. All right, so just wanted to show you that. I'm going to dig into one of these sites in this video, so stay tuned. So welcome back, guys. Now this is the hypogeum of Hal Safleni in Malta, and it's classified as a prehistoric underground temple. Right, so as you can see, it's been carved straight from the rock. We've got the pillars. It's very familiar sort of architecture. It's all stylized around the roof and everything, very nicely done and just carved straight into the rock. Now we're told this was done 4,000, or the oldest parts are 4,000 years ago. So, they were doing pretty well back then with their copper tools. Look what they've done. These are, right angles, straight lines, and we've even got pillars just carved onto the rock just for decoration. As if it's not hard enough to just make the hole. This is a top view of the layout of level one. As you can see, it does have two extra levels below it, two more levels. Bit of a strange shape, a bit weird, but that may be because of it was hewn into the rock and they had to do that, but who knows? I mean, it's interesting. Here's another shot. You can see, it's got lots of stuff carved in. They're calling these temples and that, and who knows, the sort of spaces and shelves and that carved in. All nice curves everywhere. They've got a circle, stone circle carved into the floor here for some reason, some function. It looks like it's raised on an altar or something, who knows. A couple of lines here, so who knows. They're not saying much at all, they're just saying it's a burial chamber. So yeah, this is the entrance. So this is what they found. This was actually covered in 1900, and they just sort of broke through the roof when they were building something. Here's another internal picture as well. As you can see, it's double story here, but it's a lot of work. And it's done very well, very nicely, very clean. And it's very, very big as well. And this place has three levels as well, guys. So we've got ground level, middle level, bottom level. As you can see, the main level's bigger. That's sort of the entrance level has been caved in. And there is a bottom level, and it's rumored that there's doors that have been closed. You can't get to the bottom level anymore, but it's been rumored that there's doors that actually lead to more tunnels out there, or out there underground. So what do they say about the Hal Safleni hypogeum? So this is heritagemalta.org. It's an underground prehistoric burial site discovered in 1902 during construction works. The site was first excavated by FR, I'm not sure what that is, Fryer maybe, Emmanuel Magri between 1903 and 1906. Magri died in Tunisia and his excavation notes have never been found. Excavations were taken over by Sir Themistocles Zammit, who continued work until 1911. Then the hypogeum is a complex made up of interconnecting rock cut chambers set on three distinct levels. The complex was used over a span of many centuries, with the earliest remaining remains dating back to 4000 BC. The uppermost level consists of large hollowed out burial chambers. These may have originally been exposed to the sky, they're not sure, and was covered up when they found it. The doorway leads to the middle level, which contains some of the best known features. These include intricate red ochre wall paintings and beautifully carved features that recall architectural elements common in contemporaneous megalithic temples. Ooh. Basically, it's a three-level site. It's an ancient site. They're saying it's about 4,000 years, or the oldest parts of it. It was discovered in 1902. The guy who discovered it died a few years later, and his notes have never been found. So we go to here. This is Guide Me Malta, in the oldest underground temple and necropolis in the world. The House Safiani Hypogeum in Malta was discovered a collection of skulls that show peculiar abnormalities or pathologies, sometimes inexistent or non-existent, cranial knitting lines, abnormally developed temporal partitions, and evidence of drilling and swelling at the back of the head, possibly from recovered traumas, and the strangest of all, a lengthened skull less lacking a fossa median, the joint that runs along the top of the skull. The reasons for these abnormalities have been shrouded in mystery. Until 1985, the unearthed skulls were on display at the National Museum of Archaeology. Strangely, Heritage Malta, the authority responsible for Malta's prehistoric heritage, removed them from public view around 30 years ago, and since then they have only been available by researchers to researchers by special permission. Okay, so that's interesting. So they've discovered skulls in 1902, and obviously this was written on the paper, work that was lost. So what they're saying is evidence of drilling and swelling at the back of the head, possibly from recovered trauma. So that's surgery. They're saying some of these skulls had surgery on them and they survived through the surgery because the wounds had healed over. They were elongated skulls. They had a different biological makeup. They were lacking, fossa medians, which is the pits on the inside of your skull. And yeah, sometimes non-existent cranial knitting lines, which is what we have, which is so that our skulls can compress for birth, and then they can expand basically after birth. So these skulls did not have them. This is what they're talking about. This is a cranial knitting. We have like three, and these don't. These guys just have one line across the back, and they've got other differences, physical differences in the skull, apart from the apparent size. All right, and so it says Heritage Malta outright dismisses all the theories floating about related to certain pre-Sailing skulls, all this kind of stuff. And they set out to completely bust the myth regarding the elongated skulls at the refurbished visitors centre at the House Safiam Hypogeum. So why so much effort to dissuade anyone from believing that anything extraordinary had been found down there? Because we do have these skulls, so it's a good question. We have them anyway. We know they're around, even though these guys are trying to deny it. So the abnormalities, here we go, more abnormalities, a bit more about the differences with the skulls. And this really sort of just tells a bit more about how Malta, Heritage Malta, just saying the spokesman for Ministry of Culture has downplayed the mystery, telling Loving Malta that the skulls are not even elongated and frequently made available to researchers. Yes, a lot of requests have been made in the past 10 years. Most people request to look at them. Since they are not on display, Heritage Malta gets them out of storage, and the officials from the agency accompany the visitors during the whole stage. As a rule, permissions are not only granted to researchers, the ministry are only granted to researchers. Once researchers realize that the skulls are not in fact elongated, elongated, most people subsequently drop their request. So what they're doing is they're just showing them different skulls and saying, well, no, there's nothing strange here. And so they're just denying the whole thing. Basically, the same story we always get. And here it says that in the discovery, there was 7,000 skeletons found, and some reports say up to 33,000 skeletons. That number was reduced down to 100, and then out of that, only 20 of the skulls were said to have survived, and now it's down to 6. So they've just been, destroying and getting rid of them, whatever they do, I'm not sure. Then there's also stories of giant humanoids living in hidden caverns below the already subterranean Halesafian hypogeum, and also the unconfirmed disappearance of 30 children and a teacher on a school tour of the catacombs whose cries were said to have been heard all over the island. So let's hope a new study can be put into play. So there's also stories of school children going missing. This is Guide Me Malta. One of the more intriguing stories to come out of the Maltese Islands tells of 30 school children who they say were forever lost in the hidden underground tunnels accessible from the Halesafiani hypogeum. The tale has even made the headlines in national newspapers. The story is now the stuff of legend, with many claiming it's a hoax of sorts and others believing it to be truth, which someone has an interest in keeping hidden. God, sorry, I can't read. The story is now the stuff of legend, with many claiming it is a hoax of sorts and others believing it to be a truth which someone has an interest in keeping hidden. Here's the available information so you can make up your own mind. So I'll leave all these links in the descriptions, but you can see, these are tunnels that they've found underground. Obviously, the authorities have found them and just whacked their pipes and stuff in them. Now, these look to be, chiseled straight from the rock. There's a few more pictures down of them. It also says that there was a National Geographic report in 1940, August issue 1978, the National Geographic magazine. Richard Walter wrote, many subterranean passageways, including ancient catacombs, now are a part of the island's fortification and defense system. Supplies are kept in many tunnels, and others are bomb shelters beneath Valletta. Some of the underground areas served as homes of the poor. Prehistoric men built temples and chambers in these vaults. In a pit beside one sacrificial altar lies thousands of human skeletons. Years ago, one could walk underground from one end of Malta to the other. The government closed the entrance to these tunnels after school children and their teachers became lost in the labyrinth while on a study tour and never returned. So that was published. So the story was actually published in the National Geographic. So there we go. But obviously, the government are denying that it ever happened because they actually never went and looked for them. And the stories are because they didn't want to go down there. Here's just another article which just talks about all the different tunnels underneath Malta. And here they are again. Tons of them. So we have all these ancient sites on Malta. We have the oldest underground hypogeum, they're calling it. And then we have children that have gone missing, that have gone down there. And we also have all these stories of skulls, elongated skulls. So what's going on here? Okay, so elongated skulls, a bit more on this. You probably know a bit. Brian Forster was getting DNA testings done. So alien skulls, shock verdict. DNA test results on the elongated skulls discovered in Peru have been released by a researcher investigating if the bones could belong to an alien race. Now, the 3,000-year-old Paracas skulls with elongated craniums have long been held up by UFO hunters as evidence of ancient alien visitations due to the extraordinarily huge foreheads. Now, I mean, that's a possibility, but alien doesn't mean they're necessarily from a different place. They could just be a species that evolved alongside us. They could have evolved before us. There's other interesting ways that they can go as well, which I want to get into in later videos. But yeah, basically, the DNA tests are saying that they're not us. They're two different to us. They're not this isn't like an adaptation or anything. In 2015, discussing earlier DNA tests on the remains, he said the mitochondrial DNA, now mitochondrial DNA is the DNA that's passed down from mothers, so we all have it. And what it is, it's like a set point, so it passes down the same DNA from mother to child, and that DNA stays the same, and it's almost so it keeps, it's a what's the word I'm looking for, but it's basically something that will keep all the other DNA stable. So if mutations happen, it's you're still going to get the right DNA passed down. So that's what mitochondrial DNA is, and from the mother. It presented mutations unknown to any man, primate, or any other animal, and the mutation suggested we are dealing with a completely new human-like being, very distant Homo sapien, very distant from Homo sapiens, Neanderthals, and Denisovans. I'm not sure if it will ever fit into the known evolutionary tree. And that's what we're dealing with. This is what the DNA is saying now, because all this DNA gene stuff is all still fairly new. We're still learning what's going on. I mean, and what they think they know about genes and DNA is changing pretty quick as well. But there you go. We have them. We've got the DNA results on them, and they were found in Malta. Now, of course, Malta. We've all heard of the Maltese cross. There it is, right? The Maltese cross. Lots of fire departments use it. It gets stylized a bit, but it's used a lot. There's all the different versions of it. Okay, it's a nice one. And of course, we have the Knights of Malta. And who's involved in the Knights of Malta? Well, we have, Pope here, we have the Queen. We have Prince here. We have. He just looks like a. Doesn't look like a nice boy, does he? But obviously, we've got all the priesthood, all these secret societies are tied up with the Knights of Malta, Maltese crosses, and that. And they love to wear these big Maltese crosses on their left shoulders, which you'll probably notice if you get into looking at all these pictures. But yeah, it's very tied up with all the. The rulers, the royal families, the people who are ruling the military industrial complex, they're all signed in. And even, like their kids, like oh God, what's his name again? I've forgotten his name. Prince Charles, like well, God knows what he's done, but I saw one before of Philip, not Philip, what's his name? William, with a big Maltese, costume on. Oh, here's one of him. What's he doing with all this get-up? What's he like? So it's obviously it's just a secret society, and they wear funny clothes. There's nothing. So you've got to be invited into it, obviously, and we're not. And so the Maltese. So this is what I'm trying to get at, is we have all these ancient sites. We have all these elongated skulls found, and we have Malta is tied to obviously a Maltese cross. And the Knights of Malta, which is just tied straight to the elites. So what's really going on here? Because if we start to look back into history, we start to see that the rulers of places like ancient Egypt all had these elongated skulls. Now, you can't see his skull there, but look at the top of his ear. Okay? Put a finger next to your top of your ear and run it across and see where it ends up. It'll end up about here in your eye. Look at his. So this dude's got a massive, massive head. That's Akhenaten. He's an interesting figure. This is Brian Forster. He's holding obviously a huge, huge cranium there. So we have these. We do have these skulls. This is Nefertiti. Look at the size of that one. And that's a true to life sculpture. Look at her face. They're not trying to make her look weird or anything. They're trying to show her actual likeness. Pre-Inca and Egyptian. And look, you can see the shape. It's just the same. And then we have Jacob Rothschild, and he's got a good noggin on him too, hasn't he? I mean, look at that. His forehead's literally about as high as the rest of his face is low. So what's going on here? Are these elongated head people? We're told that they all disappeared around 2,000 years ago, but maybe they haven't. Maybe they're still around. So that's something that we will get into in subsequent videos. So thanks for watching, guys. Let me know what you think about all this. And obviously, as always, leave me a comment, subscribe, like, and share my videos as it helps the algorithm, helps these videos to be put out in front of new people so we can get this information out there. All right, thanks for watching. Have an amazing day, and I shall catch you on the next upload. Bye for now.